introduce myself, which can explain more or less what I'm going to say in a second. I'm coordinating together with Lorenzo a project called Transnational Dialogues, which is an exchange and research project across China, Brazil, and Europe, involving artists, architects, designers, doing experimental research across a few issues such as the commons, such as the role of the artist, and utopias, and many, many, many other things. We published a few journals aside doing many activities in the past years. We will distribute them around. So that's the starting point. I will start my very brief intervention speaking about facts that happened a few days ago. A philosopher, theorist, that many of you certainly know, Franco Berardi, published a post on Facebook on the 2nd of May saying, I am on the side on those who on the side of the casseur of the 1st of May, because I think that they did something that was at least made explicit that the expo is not what it wants to appear. And he actually he released an interview in a magazine, which I actually don't often read, but the interview is quite interesting. And he said one thing. I translated very roughly, and he says, well, but can we think that the solution is to smash shop windows? Of course not. It is not. I think that things will change when the cognitive labor will start to enter a process of self-organization. So basically, what he says is that, well, the world can change when the cognitive labor will change. And I think this is very relevant for the theme of AB Strike. So it is not just artists, please forgive me that. It is everyone who uses his or her own brain to run things, to run activities, to create. So there's many people. And it is complex. The speaker before us simply highlighted the complexity of the argument, which is a key topic. So very very briefly, I will just tell about two examples of how cognitive labor can be made in a different way. One is it's called Zajia Lav, who is a totally self-organized, independent, well, it used to be actually, totally self-organized art organization in Beijing. They established themselves in the very center of Beijing. It was run by a sinologist, an Italian sinologist, and her partner, who is a Chinese filmmaker, and did an amazing job. And they had been doing that for many, many years in the center of Beijing, in the Hutong, in the nice area, according to our European gates, because it's old, so we like it. The Chinese didn't like it very much because it was old. So that is how this organization happened to prosper, anyway, to be able to survive. But then, since the Chinese, being very smart, they understood that the old area was fashionable and profitable, they decided to do urban development also in the Hutong area, in the very center of Beijing. And so the Zajia Lab, this organization, they at first they tried to cope with the rise of the rent, So the price of the cocktails went up from 4 euros, 5 euros to 6 euros, which is a lot in Beijing. But still, you can decide whether or not to drink your martini. You can still have a beer, which is cheap. So that's a fair, I would say, a fair way to maintain yourself. But then the situation became unbearable. But they could have resisted because those places which mix culture and everything, they are very fashionable. The culture, art, fashion, whatever, it's a fun mix. You can make money out of it. It's Punta Rodogana, it's Pinot. So it works in a way. But they decided to give up. So they closed the space and they moved many kilometers away, outside the fifth ring of Beijing, in the outskirts of Beijing. Because only there they can create, they make things happen. So they retreated, but bringing now my second case in my very short and disorganized speech, it was not, they didn't flee, they just made a very wise decision, because what's happening in Beijing, what is happening in Venice and in all over the world, is a process that can be fought in many ways. And one way is simply to ignore it. Because representation is key now. It's how you represent things. And so this place, the Jalab, decided that, okay, let's leave this game to other people. But it happens also in São Paulo. Within our project, we managed to meet many people. And we had a meeting a month ago in São Paulo in a place called Punta Roda, which is a self-organized independent space, very active. And one of the artists collaborating with the space, we were talking about marginality, and he said, well, but I'm sorry, I don't understand your argument. I think that I'm not marginal. It's the rich people, that they are the margin of São Paulo. I walk in the street, I live in the street. Is those who drive their cars from their condominiums for shadows to the workplace, to the shopping mall, they are marginals. The street is mine, it's not them. They are afraid of the street, they don't like it, they fear it. So what I would like to stress is also that we should be, I would say, less afraid to be proud of what we do, even if it's not generally conceived as a particularly accepted thing. So escaping, fleeing a certain mainstream, it is really key, and it's a powerful act, and unfortunately, it's probably the most powerful tool in the hands of the cultural workers. So to simply find other ways, because the center is so corrupted that it's not viable.